Okay, so my speech today will be about volume technique application. Just a little helpful tips and tricks. How many of you do only classic lashes? Is everyone volume trained? You only do classic?
Tatiana?
Okay. And everyone is volume trained, yeah? Perfect. So I'm not going to teach you any techniques. I'm not going to tell you how they're supposed to be, the fans, yeah? Because you all trained. You probably heard lots of, you know, tips from different teachers. But there are some tips and tricks to make it a lash application, to last longer, like a retention, yeah, which is very, very important with volume lashes. And because I've been traveling quite a lot with my trainings and also judging, and I could see the retention is the biggest problem when girls doing volume lashes. So lash tips and tricks. It's so many things adding up, you know, so we need to know how to make it your volume set last longer. And also, I will ask you, do you want to be just a lash technician or do you want to be lash expert and lash artist? So if you set goal for yourself and you want to be better as you can be, we need to know those little things, yeah? So first of all, when we do volume lashes, of course, it's very, very important health of natural lash. We're not just placing like a chunk of the extensions on one natural lash. It's very important to cleanse very well natural lashes. So that's why I say no cutting corners, because we sometimes think, okay, just a little bit clean, maybe a little bit primer on top, and it's done. Now, if you want your volume fans like set and cure much, much, much faster on a natural lash, we need to start from scratch, yeah? We need to make sure we're cleaning very well. And probably everyone will think, okay, what she's talking, I know everything, yeah? But as I said, I saw lots of girls who not necessarily doing bad work, but sometimes something is missing, yeah? So I will show you one video. It doesn't matter what brush you're using for cleansing lashes. It can be your own, but please, when you choose the cleansing brush, choose very, very fine fiber brush and soft, so you're not scratching the skin under eyes. And why I'm using the brush? Because, let's say, I always say no, no, no to micro brushes and no, no, no to like a lipsticks, like, you know, those sponge applicators, yeah? Because imagine, when you're cleaning your hair, when you're washing your hair, you don't put the shampoo on the head and just like rub it, yeah? And rinse. No, you go in between your hair. So it's the same with the natural lashes. They are here, yeah? We need to go in between and wash everything what is in between each natural lash. So, I'll show you a little video. Let's say I used the foam. Sorry, it didn't show. So I go like quite rough, not just on the surface. And then it's a little bit shortened. I don't want you to watch 20 minutes video. I never use cotton pad to wipe residue of the foam, and then I'm rinsing. Actually, I'm using saline water, not just a distilled water, but saline solution. And not just a few drops, but I'm kind of soaking wet. So if there's some foam left, your glue not gonna work and it's not gonna attach. Yeah, so we need to make sure we're cleansing everything. If someone using the same technique of cleansing, please make sure that you always turn client's head on the side, because otherwise the water and or saline will go into the eye. Yeah, so it's really, really important to turn the head. And actually, we don't have a sound here. Maybe we have it. Oh, she said it's so nice. And probably everyone sometimes at the beginning scared of doing that because they think that client will jump. But it's not a big problem. So let's say we cleanse the lashes, yeah? And again, we all experienced to place the iPads, yeah? But how many of you had these problems? iPads get wrinkled, iPads going into the client's eye, then client starts staring. Yeah, we all been there. We all went through this. So again, we need to make sure that we are avoiding placing the iPad too close to the waterline. Yeah. So there is like a steps how I'm placing the iPad. So they always sit nicely, not getting wrinkled, and client can stay for 2 hours without tearing up. So if you would like to write or take a photo, it doesn't matter, you can do it. So first of all, never ask client to look up when you place the iPad. And that's actually the way we've been taught years ago. So when the client looks up, you're placing the iPad, she's closing the eye, and iPad shoots straight into the eye. Yeah? So there's so many different methods, but that's the one you can use it also if you like it. I ask client to look straight, and then if I'm applying iPad on the right eye, I ask client to look to the left side. So I'm fixing first outer corner, and then again I'm asking client to look straight. I'm fixing the mid part of the eye. And then at the same time when she's closing the eye, I'm fixing the inner corner. So iPad sits nicely. Okay, we have those kind of situations when client, just the iPad doesn't fit particular client's eye shape, yeah? And then we're trying to make it happen. Yeah, like wrinkling. No, don't waste your time. Just, I'll go a little bit faster. Just use sometimes 2 iPads, yeah? If you can, place first in inner corner, like this. Then you can get very, very easy to the inner corner lashes. And then if you want, you can place another one on top. But let's say for the girls who lashing one eye at a time, you can lash from outer corner till mid of the eye, finish, wait a few minutes, or use NanoMista if someone using, and then use the same iPad for the inner corner. Yeah? Okay, so let's go back. Why I'm talking about the iPads? I know it looks like it's a beginner's course. But that's really important, especially when you work with volume. If your iPads are too high, it's very, very hard to place the fan on a natural lash. So we need to make sure that we're helping ourselves. About the isolation, when we work with the curved tweezer, there is no possible, like, you know, to come close to the base of the natural length. So again, we probably all think, no, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that. Again, I trained over 1,000 students and I saw 80% wrong isolations. So isolating too high, you can miss the baby lashes. As you can see in the first, on the left side, baby lashes are sitting close, yeah? So you sometimes can catch baby lash instead of you applying your fan on your chosen natural lash. If you isolating and natural lashes are overlapping, also there's no chance your fan will sit correct. Pushing lashes to one side. Now is getting popular technique when you isolating with the needle, like a lash needle. Nothing is wrong with that, but you really need to have a steady hands and very good eyes. So you're just really placing on one lash. Because when you're pushing to the side some natural lashes, There are, as I said, baby lashes sometimes in your way. Yeah. If you've been trained properly how to use lash needle, it's fine. Pressing too hard to the lid, as you can see, looks that, you know, why is pressing to the lid is not good? You probably all know of pressure. And by pressing to the lid, you gently, slowly opening client's eye. So the vapors of the adhesive will go to the client's eye. And then client starts tearing. So please, please make sure you support when you isolate. You support your elbow. And then you can touch iPad with the tweezers, but don't press it. Don't use the pressure. Yeah, so better to support your elbow on a pillow. And just one of the isolating, like how it can be done. One of the ways. Also, if you're struggling with volume lashing and isolation, who works from back of the hand and who works from the lash palette or plate on the side? Okay, I will ask it differently. Who works from the back of the hand? Mm-hmm. Okay, pretty many. And who works from the, well, I would say half-half. Okay. So there's no bad and no good, yeah? But you need to remember that if you work from back of your hand, you have to pick up glue the last minute. Because if you pick up the fan from the hand, then you're going to isolate, yeah? If you dipped in the glue before you start isolating, your glue is almost dry. So your fan will stick on a natural lash, but it's not gonna give you good retention. Okay, so pick up the fan, isolate, glue on a lash. It's like a golden rule. And everyone says, I do that. Uh-huh. It's a habit. Glue and then isolate. But who works from the lash plate or palette? You can isolate first, pick up fan, glue, and on the lash. Yeah? You wanted to ask something? No? So please remember that. So one tip, if someone working from the back of the hand, yeah, picking the lashes, if you're not so fast with isolation with one hand, you can actually tape some layers up and help yourself. So it's easy for you to isolate quicker. But please be aware, someone's using micropore tape to do that, yeah? Detacking skin of cells and everything, yeah? I prefer gel-free iPads for this technique, so you don't need to detack many times, yeah? So always work safe. And even if you detack a few times, you tape a few layers up, and then when you need to remove that micropore tape, lash is stuck. It happens, yeah? So be careful with this method, so use safely, okay? Now, if you wanna be perfect lash artist and you competing in the lash competitions, which is getting really, really popular now, we need to make sure that the distance from the lid is correct. It's not just because the judges are looking at those lashes and just writing some points, yeah? But the distance from the lid is really important. Do not touch the skin, of course, everyone knows, yeah? It can be sensitivity, allergy. But if it's too far from the lid, also is not good, yeah? Because if your extensions will be placed too far from the lid, that's extra weight already on the natural lash, and after a week or two, you will get a bigger regrowth. Also, if you cannot place all the extensions at the same distance from the lid, you will get steps. Yeah? So it's not just the correct length when you're choosing helps you to avoid having those steps, but also how close you can get to the lash, to the lid. Yeah? So make sure it's always the same distance across the lash line, across the eye. So this method, why I'm using always on the side, little bit upwards. So I'm not just lifting the client's skin up, but I also separating the natural lashes. So it helps me a little bit also with isolation. And then the glue, the nasty one, our enemy. We all blaming the glue that, you know, is not working, and so many now different glues in the market, and believe me, they are almost all good if you know how to use it. Of course, one glue works for you, another glue works for another one. We have preferences, yeah? But we need to know some things, because with the volume, it's really, really important how we work with adhesive and how much adhesive we pick up. So as I always say, bigger sometimes better. Not how much glue we're picking up, not more glue, but I mean how big drop we're using if we work from the stone, yeah, or crystal. Why I always say use bigger drop? Because it lasting slightly longer than tiny drop. So that means you're opening your glue bottle less times, and your glue inside of the bottle gets less air and moisture. Yeah, because each time you're opening, air, moisture goes in. So I always say use slightly bigger drop. And then, oops, my mouse gone. Oh, yeah. I will show you the video. How to get rid of the residue of adhesive without wiping it on the, let's say, glue palette. Can I ask some question? And don't be shy to answer yes if you do this way. How many of you wiping the adhesive on the iPads? Please don't do that. Please don't do that. I'm the really getting a little bit psycho about this question. But, okay, not because just we watch at the competitions that is supposed to be clean, crystal clear, the iPad. Otherwise, you will get less points. But it's because you're thinking that one dot or two dots is not gonna do any harm. We don't know how sensitive client is, yeah? So if you wipe on the iPad, vapors go straight into the client's eye. And then if you just accidentally isolating, not really like correctly pressing a little bit into the lid, vapors just fly in. And it's not just my thinking. We had a very good meeting with Doug Shun. Anyone knows who this guy is? He is a very well-known, worldwide known scientologist. I keep mixing them. So he works with cyanoacrylates, formaldehyde, and things like that for CND. And now he's actually getting into the lashes. He's helping us a lot. So actually, Jill from Arizona, she's doing webinars with him time to time. So watch on Facebook if you would like to join the webinar. It's really, really interesting to hear about adhesive. And actually, last time me and Irina Revchuk were sitting and our eyes were like that. We thought we know so much. And then it's like, okay. Thanks for telling us that. So yes, be careful. He actually said, please, you don't know the chemical reaction when it touches the iPad, yeah? And the fumes and vapors going straight into the client's eye. So be careful, okay, with that. Better to wipe it somewhere on a, I don't know, on a crystal or somewhere else, but not on an iPad. But again, I'm this kind of person who always says, try do not wipe. Try to pick up correct amount of the adhesive straight away. And if you didn't pick it up correct, then it's good to know how to get rid of it, yeah? So let's see.
Oops.
Let's say I picked up too much. That would be too much to place it on the natural lash, that bead. So I'm going again into the adhesive and going very slowly, slowly out, backwards. And this drop disappeared. So your glue is fresh and you can place it on a natural lash. So what happens when you wipe it? Okay? You don't know how much you wiped, how much adhesive stayed on your plate. So again, it might be stick, but it could give you good retention or maybe not. Who knows, yeah? Because if you just like pressed it too hard. And as soon as adhesive touches some surface, either natural lash or some palette, glue palette, it starts drying. So that's why, you know, retention issues can start. Okay? I'm losing my mouse. So about the pickup again, volume fan, it can be 2D, 3D, 4D, and more and more and more. So how much adhesive we have to pick up so your fan stays open, not closing, yeah? Or it's enough glue, we're not using just a little. Because looking now through old Instagrams and Facebooks, there's so many beautiful pictures. But so many also, as they say, lash pornography. Everyone tries now to do as wide as possible fans. Yeah, where's the limit? Yeah, where's the limit? How wide your fan supposed to be? Okay, that's my next topic. In next conference. I'm not going to tell everything today. So, but let's say you know how wide your fan supposed to be. If you're using too little adhesive, your fan not going to last as long as possible, as long as you want. But also when the natural lash will grow, your fan will start moving to the sides. Because if you're using little glue, you're getting super tiny base. And then it's not going to last. But if you pick up more adhesive, too much, then your fan's usually closing up. So we need to find the happy medium. So let's say with the classic lash, with one lash, you going into the glue and taking that out. So it can pick up only adhesive on top of the extension. With the volume fan, we have multiple bases, yeah? And we have little tunnels inside, which are invisible. So for you, sometimes it's enough just to touch adhesive and the glue shoots up. You don't see that from outside, it's inside. So you're going again in the glue, and again in the glue. Why I'm saying that? I've seen so many times. And then you're placing on the natural lash, and it's like closing. So this video actually showing, oh my God, I'm bad. How much glue, oi, and again, Inessa, help. I don't know, maybe you will see. Sorry, it's upside down. Can you see the line? I draw it with the glue. I barely touch the adhesive. I will repeat. Sorry that it's upside down. It didn't meant to be like this. So we would think that it's not enough, but believe me, that would be more than enough, because when you place it on a natural lash, this tiny glue which sits at the base will go up and it will create for you 1.5 millimeter base. And your fan will stay open. But if we pick up too much, we need to be careful, so we need to then maybe hold extra 5 seconds. Your fan, because it depends how much glue you're picking up. Your 1 or 2 second drying adhesive can become 6 and 7 seconds adhesive if you pick up too much. Okay? Right, now we are probably all professionals and we can pick up eyelash fan very, very fast. Yeah, because to pick up and make a beautiful fan, it's only 30% of your work done. And then it all depends on application, how you applying it. Because that's the hardest part for most of the, I would say, beginners. When you are getting more and more experience, it's becoming easier, yeah? But it's never easy. I still sometimes screaming and shouting, sometimes those days, one of those days. It's like, oh, I want to throw my tweezers. So, and especially if your natural lash growing to the side, yeah? Not the correct direction. So how to correct? Let's say this, let's pretend that this is natural lash and it's growing to the left side. We would all think, like with classic lashes, we would place fan from the right side, isn't it? Just to correct the grow direction. It can work, but most of the times it drops to the side. So what is good to do, bring your tweezers like a kind of twist. So you're placing the fan from the left side, but not bringing your tweezers from the left side, but you're going from underneath and hugging the natural lash. Where's my mouse? As you can see, I went from underneath. And always gently, gently press to the natural lash. So if you have a fresh glue, it actually helps the bases to go around natural lash. But if you had your glue like waiting for you a few seconds, you pick the fan, you dip in the glue, isolate it, dry it almost. You went to place it on a natural lash. It's not gonna wrap, it's not gonna hug natural lash. It's gonna create flat base. Because the glue almost dried. It will stick. It will stick like a classic lash, on top, sideways, or underneath. But it's not gonna do any movements. And just a little technique how to help you if you would like to try that technique. It's pretty fast and you can create fans very, very easy. There's some steps. You really, that's the way I do it. There's so many, many wiggle techniques, rocking techniques. They're slightly different, yeah? But let's say I do this way. I peel slightly extensions from the strip towards me, let go. Then I place my tweezer on the strip. I'm not holding somewhere in the air. I firmly place it on the strip. And I do slow movements, but big movements to one side, another side. With this technique, you can do it. Let's say when you have a strip, you're right-handed, you pick up extensions from the right side. But I found it much, much easier if you pick up extensions from the left side. It fans much, much easier. But remember, if you're picking up from the left side, you always pull them first to the right side and then to the left. So it's pretty quick. You can do that from the right side, but believe me, try from the left side. Much, much easier. And I think that's it.
Thank you.